third.
Change.
Yes, 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 yes. Because now, in fact, we didn't do it in the morning because we had, you know, not everyone had come in before we started the previous session. But it may be nice to start with a round of introductions so that I think lots of people in the room know each other, but not everyone knows everyone. So just quickly, just, you know, your name and the organization you've come from, and if you have, you know, just a, you know, brief introduction. Yeah, please start, Rajiv.
Yeah, maybe I'll start because I'm perhaps the newest face in the room, except for Joseph and Santosh. I don't know many people here. So I'm Rajesh Rangarajan. I've recently joined WaterAid. I manage the southern office in Hyderabad. WaterAid, of course, many of you know, we look at water access and sanitation access. We've been in the water sector for the last 25 years or so. Our particular focus, of course, is rural and marginalized districts, drinking water supply and sanitation access. I am here by virtue of some of the work that I've done in the past in the in the sectors that are not relating to WASH, primarily from hazardous waste, solid waste, healthcare waste, and so on, and also some experience working with the State Pollution Control Board for a couple of years, which actually helped me understand both the constraints under which they operate and the sort of the regular criticisms that they get on, you know, like Santosh was saying, why things are not implemented. But I also got a sort of inside view of some of the constraints that they face in implementing something that's new, that's something beyond their sort of understanding and how they really go about it. So I hope to share some of that in the next 10, 15 minutes. Thanks.
I'm Arkaja from the Center for Policy Research, and you've all had emails from me and WhatsApp messages from me and everything, so I don't think I need to introduce myself any further.
Good morning. My name is Oblesh. I came from Karnataka. I am working with the manual scavengers community, Safai Karmachari.
Good morning, I'm Tina Mathur. I work with the PMU situated at the Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs.
I am Juhi Jain. I work with Center for Advocacy and Research, and we work across 10 states, and in 3 states we are working on urban sanitation issues from a gender perspective with urban communities.
Maybe Girija, Center for Advocacy and Research.
I am Sanjay Singh. I'm from Population Services International. PSI mostly works on urban health, and we also work on urban-rural sanitation as well.
Hi, my name is Neha. I am a research associate at the Center for Policy Research, Sci-Fi Group. Thanks.
Hi, Prashant. I am Prashant, I'm an RA with the Sci-Fi group here at CPR.
Hi, I'm Aditya and I work with the Center for Policy Research, Sci-Fi project.
Hi, I'm Parag. I'm doing some legal research for CPR on urban wastewater management.
I'm Santosh. I'm from IHS.
I'm Yogini. I work for Sci-Fi CPR.
Hi, I'm
sorry to have missed it then. I'm sure we fantastic. Well, then you've introduced me. I'm an environmental lawyer, also a fellow at the Center for Policy Research.
Hello, I'm Amrish. I'm senior research associate working with Sci-Fi CPR.
Hello, I'm Arthur Srinivasan. I'm working with USAID in the WASH team.
Hi everyone, I'm Krishna Swarup. I'm from CDD Society.
I'm Deepthi and I work with Sci-Fi at CPR.
Hi, I'm Clara. I work for USAID.
I am USAID and work in Sci-Fi team, Center for Policy Research.
I'm Jagdeep Singh. I work at Sci-Fi
Hi, I'm Anandita Mukherjee. I also work for Sci-Fi and Center for Policy Research.
Hi, I'm Vanshree. I'm from the Amrut team in the Ministry of Urban Development.
My name is Manish. I'm a lawyer and I'm a research associate at CPR.
Now we're done and I'll hand over to Anandita who will moderate the session because I'm also going to present, so she'll also so she'll moderate and keep us in order in the session.
Yeah, so thank you for that round of introduction. That was useful and would help each other know each other better. So because Rajesh is the first presenter in this session and already introduced himself, so I will not get into the modalities of introducing Rajesh. Rajesh is working in WaterAid and he is the regional manager South in the WaterAid, and he would speak today on environmental regulations and consider various issues relating to the applicability of these regulations to, you know, fecal sludge and septage management. So I'll hand it over to Rajesh. Thanks.
Yeah. Thank you, Anandita, and thank you, Arkaja. Like I said, you know, I'm going to draw on some experiences from the past that I've had in understanding environmental governance and implementation of environmental laws, specifically relevant to waste management sector, and also to some of the other issues on coastal management. And so on, urban governance to urban laws. I would like to share it as three specific buckets of issues, which I think be most useful for this discussion. Again, you know, I couldn't, like I said, since the ecosystem is fairly new to me, I've tried to relate what I know from the ecosystem to what I already had experience with. So in case you have clarifications or things to add on, I'll try and see if I can draw on some of my experiences and see if that's relevant. So the first thing that I want to discuss or just sort of highlight is what has not really worked in the context of centralized approaches, right? Particularly, you know, urban wastewater management and also industrial effluent treatment, trade effluent treatment, right? Both of these issues, I think we will have an understanding, particularly from the point of view of what the Pollution Control Board can do, cannot do. If it was, you know, a law was designed and given to them for implementation, then how are they really going to, you know, go about doing it, and can they really do it? The second issue I will touch upon is, you know, what sort of additional mechanisms were really needed? You know, maybe Shivani can compliment me there. On there's always been a need for some sort of additional mechanisms. No law, you know, in general, I think, you know, this is a fairly cliche statement, but we have good laws, but implementation is the issue. So in general, with that sort of a thing, we learn that despite having well-written laws, you need to have different kinds of innovative monitoring mechanisms to ensure that these laws work. So that's, again, I'm going to draw upon a 2003 order of the High Court on hazardous waste management and how that actually literally changed the way implementation of hazardous waste happened in the country. And to some extent also the recent NGT order on the solid waste management rules 2016, where it chose to establish multiple levels of monitoring committees. Finally, I'm going to draw, and I think this will probably be the most interest to all of you, is that if you look at the sanitation value chain and if you overlay that with the entire healthcare waste management processes, systems and law that this country saw from 2000 onwards and where it stands now, I think there's a fairly strong overlap between what you're discussing as FSM and what, you know, I've actually had a chance to experience in the healthcare waste management sector. You're talking about complex waste. Of course, you know, it's not as complex in the FSM case, but you're talking about infection, you're talking about chemical waste handling, you're talking about containment, storage, final disposal, siting standards, and a whole bunch of stuff, which I think we can draw from the healthcare waste management ecosystem. Okay, so I have a lot of Chennai examples. I am from Chennai myself. And to add on to what Santosh had said, we have to look at the Metro Water's experience in the way that it has been handling sewage. And if you look at the peri-urban areas in Chennai, they pretty much do what you're talking about, that they actually contract it out to a range of formal and informal operators who go to various parts and actually desludge. And then they are supposed to bring it to the effluent treatment plant in South Chennai, Perumbudi, which receives about, I'm not sure, Santosh can correct me if I'm wrong. So the total waste that the dump yard receives is about 4,500 tons per day. I'm not exactly sure the number of the effluent load that it receives, but I know a lot of these operators actually desludge, and none of this actually reaches the effluent treatment plant. I have actually seen these being, dumped in the Pallikarnai Marsh, which is around the effluent treatment plant. So the significant thing that we need to look at is, how are we going to ensure that the waste that will actually reach the FSTP? And that is a significant question to ask. Even in healthcare waste management, this is the same problem, though healthcare institutions do a lot to ensure that the waste is handled well. Whether it finally reaches the common treatment facility is something that we need to look at. With reference to industrial effluent, again, there are standards for both these trade effluents and sewage treatment plants. They're all there. Industrial effluent, interestingly, what's been happening is that TDS, total dissolved solids, is a particular cause of concern for industrial effluents. And the Pollution Control Board is very sort of blinkered on ensuring that this TDS comes down, right? So I don't know if TDS is going to be an issue with fecal sludge. We could look into that in the second half of the day. But with that in mind, actually a lot of raw sewage is being mixed with trade effluent in order to get the TDS down. And we've also seen that raw effluent is being bought by industries these days. It is actually a mandate by state pollution control boards in different states. Tamil Nadu, I know for sure, that the industrial belt in North Chennai, a lot of the industries are asked to purchase raw sewage from Chennai Metro Water, and they treat them, and they actually use them for their boiler and other industrial processes. So how much of the sewage is actually going to get captured in a fecal sludge management system is also something that we need to look at based on these experiences. Okay, so going on to, these are some preliminary points. So if you have any questions, I can build on it. The second set of issues is these additional mechanisms. Now, there's always been compliance issues with any system process that has been laid out, any law that has come about. Santosh was talking about the capacity of pollution control boards, and I've spent a couple of years with them, and one of my roles was actually to build capacities for some of the line management officials on issues of healthcare waste management. A large part of my work was involved in trying to get them to understand, learn and unlearn some of the things that they've already been doing as business as usual. So they are highly engineering society. So they'll be happy to look at everything from an engineering perspective. And the laws that have been previously written also were attuned to, looking at this as an engineering principle. But we are now looking at very innovative, laws and policies that would require multidisciplinary approaches and not just a sort of pollution control board, one size fits all implement. I'll go and I'll close the wall, I'll cap the incinerator or something like that, right? So with this understanding growing, in the 2003 hazardous waste case, the hazardous waste management law, was enacted in 1994, 1998, I'm not sure. And since then, there was increasingly a lot of violation of industries dumping sludge. There was a question about sludge. So again, this is going to be, FSM sludge is going to be tricky. Standard setting for sludge is extremely complex. And in the case of FSM, I think you're going to have both chemical components and you're going to have biological components. So that's going to throw a separate set of challenges on standard setting. So given that there was increasingly non-implementation of the hazardous waste rules, a case was brought about. And the court actually said, the Pollution Control Board has failed in implementing this law completely. And it actually went about setting up something called the Supreme Court Monitoring Committee in all states. And then the Supreme Court Monitoring Committee went and created local area environment committees, which was highly localized to industrial estates. And they actually, underwent a learning of this hazardous waste management rules and what the court had ordered. And they became the eyes and ears of the court in order to implement the hazardous waste management regulations. So I was part of one of the committee, and the tenure of the committee was for a year. And we actually traveled, made inspections, and we saw that there was a complete mismatch between what the community understood as what the industry was doing and what the industry perception of what the community was opposing. So, for example, in the PNP case, you know, that could very well be something that could be looked at, because one of my roles was actually to build that trust deficit between community and industry to share that these are the processes, these are polluting, these are not, and can we, you know, sort of sit down and have a conversation as to see how these standards apply. So these local area environment committees became extremely effective to change the entire implementation paradigm of hazardous waste. Right. So, and then it became so well sort of enshrined in the system that the pollution control board started feeling very inadequate. You know, it really didn't have a role. Pretty much the court had taken over the implementation role and so on. So then they increasingly started, you know, venturing in, and they, you know, changed these committees and all of that. And then there was this centralized model that eventually happened, where we have a toxic sludge disposal facility, which are all located just outside industrial facilities. And there is a contractor who operates this TSDF, and he completes the entire chain. You know, he has his trucks, he has his people, he has to train them, he has to ensure that they're all collected. And the bulk of responsibility, the onus of ensuring that it is captured and brought into the TSDF completely lies on him, and the liability is on him. And therefore, the Pollution Control Board monitoring also became easy. Right, but still, you know, as we know, in several of these systems, we still find gaps in implementation and things don't happen. Right. So this is from the hazardous waste case. With regard to the recent solid waste order by the NGT, it is actually again followed a very similar structure, where it is looking at monitoring committees at the national level, at the state level, at the local level, with a combination of government. And I think civil society is there. I'm not sure if it's true. I've not looked at the order in detail. But these kinds of committees are needed to ensure that a new rule, solid waste management. I mean, this has been around from 2000. I think the previous version was 2016. And all state governments are in, you know, city governments are in violation. And they don't have plans in place. And now there is this whole monitoring mechanism that kicks in order to ensure that this policy is actually workable. Right, this is implementable. So this has always been the case. You know, a due course of action is decided, a certain law is framed, and then we try and tinker with it to see how best it can suit our purposes. So if we were to flip it around a little bit and to do something that what I did with the Pollution Control Board before the biomedical waste rules came, I remember we had about monthly trainings for 2 years. So I was involved in about 24, 25 trainings for a couple of years, training all state engineers on the biomedical waste rules. So they were coming from district offices, regional offices, wherever, and you know, we used to keep having this. And this was a continuous capacity building exercise that was needed before they even knew what to go and monitor in healthcare institutions and to the common treatment facility to ensure that the law was being complied with. Right? Okay, so now going into, I mean, building on that. So now that we, I'll briefly talk about 2 minutes for what this whole biomedical waste management, value chain is, like you put it. So you have healthcare institutions which are generating fairly high volumes of infectious waste. You also have, to draw a parallel for the FSM, you have primary healthcare centers, which, for example, generate a lot of immunization waste, sharps waste, which are highly infectious. And that continues to pose a challenge, and how is that captured in a waste management system? So very often what is done is these the ANMs actually go implement the injections and so on. They actually bring them in a contained device, and then that is brought into a primary health center, and then that is transported back to the common treatment facility, which is located, I don't know how many kilometers, 200, 300 kilometers and so on. So healthcare waste is generated from these institutions. There is a common treatment facility operator who actually uses vans of different capacities and sizes. There are specifications for the vans. There are specifications for handling of this waste. There are specifications for pre-treatment at the site as to how much actually has to be done by the hospital before it can be picked up by the common treatment facility. And then subsequently, it is supposed to be transported not more than certain number of kilometers. If I remember, I think in a radius of not more than 200 kilometers, the van can travel with infectious waste and finally reach the facility. And waste cannot be allowed to be left in the hospitals for not more than 48 hours. So if there is more than 48 hours waste is lying in the hospital, both the hospital and the common treatment facility person can be prosecuted. Now, that's another important thing. Who is going to be prosecuted in the FSM ecosystem? That needs to be looked at. If you have a law, somebody needs to be penalized, somebody needs to be prosecuted in order to get implementation going. So who is going to be that is something that, you know, we need to look at when we're designing some new legislation. So like all other issues, siting is a big issue for these common waste treatment facilities. So in the case of the FSTP, we've seen that in the Trichy example that Santosh was talking about, that siting becomes a very critical critical component to get it right. And also we have to look at site-specific standards. Now, this is another thing that has come about in a 2008 case in Coimbatore in Mayflower Gardens with the government of Tamil Nadu, is that we need to have site-specific standards for facilities like this. We cannot have broad one-size-fits-all standards. Because we're talking about land application of the use waste, so fate transport of the leachates, what sort of soil, etc., etc. So all of these are constraints, so site-specific standards are something that we need to look at very, very closely before we design an FSTP. Collection and transportation, I think I have spent some time on it, comparing it to what the biomedical waste treatment operator does, but today we have a common biomedical waste treatment facility guidelines. Now, this is a critical thing. I mean, there was a question about whether we need to make it statutory or not. I think that's an important question to also look at, because though the biomedical waste rules is statutory, the guidelines is not. It is merely a sort of do's and don'ts for the operator. So whether he complies with it is again left to the pollution control board to monitor. The training and handling bit is extremely critical. I've noticed in the case, very briefly, I was involved 3 months in the Savda Gevra site with IWMI's work. We interacted with some of the desludging operators. They are in the informal economy. And, you know, and he actually uses a lot of other additional manpower, not just Savda Gevra, he's going into Haryana and other places as well. And we also talked to some of the handlers, and we saw the condition that which they are handling this waste. So obviously, personal protective equipment, safety, and all of those also become a particular component to look at within these rules. With regard to the FSTP itself, we've seen this in other industries, is that fugitive emissions that cannot really be tracked through a meter, controlled through a wall. It just happens because you have a large part of the sludge lying in the open. It is just escaping, and this is called fugitive emissions. You really can't track them. And this forms a large part of the pollution load compared to what actually comes from an industry, because you can actually control that with a wall. You can actually, you know, shut it off. But these are some things that cannot be tracked. So in case you have a sludge stabilization pond in an FSM system, I mean, I don't know exactly how it works, but if you have a stabilization pond, you're looking at methane emissions and other GHG emissions that would likely to be encountered with. So we need to understand whether that is something that we want to capture within the purview of standards. A final disposal I talked about. Here you also have to look at groundwater regulations and groundwater standards. You have to look at soil quality standards. You might also want to look at what is there in the air quality standards in general and see, you know, how these are applicable. If you want to look at the entire canvas, it may not be, but it might perhaps be useful to look at. When you're actually developing this, you know, analysis, regulatory analysis, I think it will be useful to take a look at this process. I would like to then sort of finally wrap up with, I was having this discussion with Ravi and Santosh, is, you know, are we going to build a law and actually hand it over to the State Pollution Control Board? Because the discussion here was, it was under the ambit of the Environment Protection Act and Water Act, and all of these acts are anyway with the State Pollution Control Board. And we find that there is a lot of, the jurisdiction is fragmented. And even when there is, it's very clear, like the biomedical waste rules, which the PCB alone has to deal with, you still find a lot of gaps, and it's taken a couple of decades for them to really get their act together. And in a situation like this, where you're having fragmented jurisdiction, and how are we going to let the TNPCB come and enforce? And what they actually know is, like Santosh was saying, switch off power, cut off water supply, and those are things that they standard. But they have no mechanism of having a proactive way of working with the stakeholders concerned to develop a roadmap for improving that. So that is really not, so it's a command and control system still. So you really don't have a avenue for that. So these are really the points that I wanted to make. I couldn't really sort of capture everything into a PPT, but I'll be happy to answer any questions and go a little deeper into any of these points.
I don't know if it was useful. Yeah, okay. It is extremely useful, and thank you for that succinct presentation. Do you think we should take question right away, or you want to park it and finish the session now as well? So anyone who have a burning question, please.
Okay. Regarding one of the question you raised, who is going to be prosecuted? Actually, we are seeing a lot of news clippings about the death in the manhole in Delhi also. And the law very strictly says that there is 2-year imprisonment and things. Do you find any case that someone, either the municipality or household, have been penalized or punished? You came across any case studies or something like that?
This is something we will deal with in the next set of presentations, because we have a set of presentations. We will be talking about manual scavenging and the law around manual scavenging just after this. But of course, it is a point, and this is something that's of concern to us, that the issue about safety remains, the issue about the workers' safety and workers' dignity remains only in the manual scavenging law and is not reflected in the wider regulation around technology and treatment systems and all that. So, that's very much linked, but We'll look at this, in some more detail in the second part.
So what I've seen with the Pollution Control Board is that they go after the industries. Very clearly it is, they know who to bill and whom to attack. But in the case of effluent treatment, and I've seen this example in Chennai, that the minute it involves contracting, the liability is passed on, right? So nobody wants to take ownership. I don't know if the state government who wants to take ownership, the city government, the industries, for example, they actually, a lot of the effluent sometimes is removed off-site and it is contracted out to someone before it reaches that sludge disposal facility, right? So, and if something happens en route, they really wash their hands off because they say that it is not their responsibility, they have contracted it out. So therein lies the confusion as to, again, who is to be prosecuted.
Yeah, Manish, go ahead.
No, so I'm wondering if similar stuff happens with the desludging operators. Like, do SPCBs, like when they dump waste in the open or into water bodies, under the Water Act has very clear sort of penalties, right? Up to 6 years of imprisonment, fines and so on, right? But do we see vehicles being impounded, people being arrested? In the sense, these are also in some ways low-hanging fruit, right? It's not just like going after some large structural problem. But I'm wondering if the SPCBs even consider that a priority.
So my first response to that is that I think I witnessed in Savda Gebra when we were actually walking through the site. The person was named, I think his name was Akram, I think. And, he, after his sludging was over, he actually went in. He told us that he has no other option. Sometimes he goes and dumps it in the Nala here or somewhere else. So he has two spots where he can do it. So once he was doing it, he was caught by a policeman to this thing. And I think, of course, it was settled there with a certain negotiation. But here again, the problem is, right, the way I would see it, it's increasingly difficult for you to target industries which are structured and so on, and you're projecting it as though it's easier to find these people in the informal sector. I would think we'll have to look at it slightly differently, because you're actually raising an angle of environmental injustice here, where it's easier to go after people in the informal economy while it's, you know, not so easy to go after people who are fairly well-structured and, you know, well-established. This is, again, a significant issue when it comes to implementation of the Pollution Control Board. None of the bigger industries, to me, have been shut down, but today we have a Trichy plant which is easily shut down. You have industries which are constantly polluting. Once in a while, their power supply and water has been cut off, but Sterlite one is a classic case, but it's happened before with small and medium enterprises and a lot of others also. They easily do that. So again, it might be a good question to understand as to, you know, who gets penalized, how much is the penalty, and so on and so forth. These are questions that you might want to look at in your later discussion. So I don't have like a ready-made answer for that.
Juhi, you had a question?
Because in Delhi, in the settlements where we are working, we have massively worked with the poor communities to de-sludge, and they are doing it. And the operator is also one of the people who are from the community. He has been specifically told to de-sludge it or to dump it into either the network transceiver or in a designated spot wherever there are no people living. But he normally does. And in fact, recently, in one of the dhalaus, it was dumped. Now, the EDMC or the SJMC has no idea what to do with it. The Delhi Jal Board has no responsibility because they say, ye hamara kaam nahi. What does a person who wants to de-sludge do? And how does he do it? Either he doesn't do it, so he's killing himself and his neighbors. If he does it, somebody else is killing. So there is nothing in place at the systemic level or at the community level or at the operator level. So it has to be something which has to fix specific responsibility for each department or for each person. It doesn't help to say that we'll go after the operator because I can go after him, he will not come to my settlement the next day. And he's getting 350 rupees. He's not even getting a big chunk of the money because his contractor is getting the money. So I think there are so many issues, and we have actually now persuaded the Delhi Jal Board to make a sort of a guideline where they are saying, okay, we will train the operators, we will make sure that they are dumping them in a proper spot. But again, the problem is there is no place where they can dump it. So they will again do it. But they will train the people that you wear gloves and you wear a mask and you don't, you know, you follow certain rules. But that is not helping in the end.
So what I have seen is that in order to ensure that the waste comes to the designated point, technology can solve that. I mean, we can do a GPS tracking and, you know, all of that. This has happened already in... Yeah. So, but again, the point here that I'm trying to make is that there is technology, but the adoption of technology is a significant hurdle. Even with private operators, like in the healthcare waste, who actually handle hazardous waste and all that, I'm talking about Ramki as one of the companies which is well established in the waste industry, in India now. Now, there is a reluctance to adopt this suggestion of GPS tracking. And they said there has to be an upgradation of the vehicles, this is additional cost, you know, this is actually being done at a low cost, no profit model, and all of that. And they actually agreed to do this when there was a co-finance project that the Pollution Control Board implemented with UNDP, where we looked at the upgradation of these vehicles. So again, at what level you want to implement this technology, and then only after you implement this technology can you then start fixing accountability on these different actors. So without that, it actually even becomes even more difficult and complicated.
And any other question? Anything? Shivani? Yeah, so just one comment to summarize this is that, you know, eventually when we fix accountability and penalization is the course of the law, the burden actually falls on the marginalized and the vulnerable, and it is always the urban poor who are anyways bearing the maximum cost of this non-fixed network solutions, and we might land up further marginalizing these segments by putting the, you know, onus on the retail part of it, as Madhu had pointed out in the morning. So we have to be very, very careful while drafting something which
make these people more vulnerable towards the, you know, they're anyways at the downstream of the supply chain, and they'll be even further pushed behind. As Zui was pointing out, they're dumping in the Dhalao. Now, you know, that is outrageous. The Dhalao are usually in the middle of the settlements. And if you're dumping the fecal waste in the Dhalao, so let's not even talk about it. Transfer waste, solid waste stations, yeah. So while fixing the accountability, we should also realize that whom are we fixing it to? The households as well as the informal operators are the fag end of the chain. And if you are actually fixing the accountability on them, you are further marginalizing people. And these informal operators are not created out of vacuum. They are coming because government has failed to provide the service at scale. And hence, we have to really think through whom we are fixing the accountability to.
To add to that, this environmental injustice issue we see in many of these installations. And very often, even the FSTPs, where are they going to be set up? You know, is it going to be a Dalit community? I mean, at the end of the day, so, you know, we need to understand how that siting process also works. And as you were speaking, I was reminded of, you know, something to add here. If you're looking at a piece of legislation to draft afresh, then I would look at something like the biomedical waste rules. That's a good lesson, because in structure and in some parts of the content where it deals with standards, deals with handling, everything is actually put in there. And in some ways, depending on the healthcare institution, the size of the healthcare institution, it is a do-it-yourself kit kind of thing, you know. So in terms of the structure, I think it's very useful to have. It's easy to sort of bring it into a regulatory framework. You can just append it to the Environment Protection Act. And then you can have certain guidelines to support it. So this could be a sort of way forward if you're looking at something new, completely new legislation, and not worry about the kind of different pieces that you need to piece together. Because I think this, it's going to be, waters is already a challenge.
Yeah.
So much fragmented jurisdiction, now this is another piece of this thing, which I find it might perhaps be easier to do something like this.
Yeah, point taken. So should we move on? Please.
Two points. One, the whole business of informal and the poor. Right? I mean, take the case of PNP. Many towns in India are going to be relying only on non-network services. So I think there's no differentiation between rich and poor. Everybody relies on a service, right? So I don't think we should have a service where say, oh, we need to take care of the poor. Because if a service is not catering for the entire town population, and you try to have a service only for the poor, it's not going to work. Believe me, it's never going to work. It's just going to collapse. And the second is the whole business of informal. If you look at the emptying business, it's primarily in India, it's provided in the informal sector. They're not, I mean, the IHS team went about the country trying to see, attract private sector to come in, and none of the large players are interested in this business. Although you may go and talk to them and say that this is the kind of business that you have, no large player is in this business. So it will be informal, and I don't see any reason why they should be informal. I mean, there is money to be made. If you ask the guys in Tamil Nadu, they're making a profit. It's not that they're doing service for free. So I think we need to be careful in the way that we convey the message that the poor are being, you know, unduly burdened, and the informal sector are the guys who don't have anything else to do, and therefore they got into this business. They are there because there is a service to be provided. And yeah, maybe we should make the service better, but let's be careful in what we say and convey the message across.
Just to clarify on that, the point that I was trying to make, it has to be accountability on the informal only. May not be the right way of going about it, because we are talking about the legal accountability. Who puts the burden on whom? So who gets penalized? If tomorrow I see that my septic tank effluent is going into the open drain, then who is penalized? The household is penalized. Yeah. So then to what proportion and for what mechanisms that one is penalized is something we need to carefully draft. I'm not saying that you cannot penalize the poor, you must penalize them if they are doing something that is out of law. But then to what extent are there services which they have violated to connect? That's why they are discharging, or they are discharging because there is no system at all. So that is something we need to take care of. But once the services are there and then I am not connecting, then yes, you are very well right to penalize, I guess. Yeah.
Customers are never going to come.
Absolutely.
So
absolutely.
Therefore, whether I'm rich or poor, I will have a septic tank, I need a service. That's what I'm trying to tell you. Not that, you know, I have a service, I didn't connect.
So therefore, we need to be careful in the language and say that the poor do not be left out. That's the only thing I'm trying to say.
Yeah,
nothing
for
else.
Sure.
The point taken. Well taken. You want to say something, Prashant? Yeah, go on. And we,
So just to follow up on this point, I think one thing is that inevitably, because these services are informal and they are in it for a profit, it's not a public service from their point of view. Very much they're approaching it as a profit-making entity, as a profit-making service. They will serve households who have capacity to pay and for whom it makes sense to, like, for them to go to. So if the household or the settlement is too far outside their service area and they can't justify that, like the cost of diesel or transport, then they won't serve that area. So whether rich or poor, there will be gray areas which these informal businesses won't serve because there's no incentive for them to serve, right? Because they are fundamentally profit-seeking, first point. So I think agree with you that the rich and poor is not really our question. Our question is like which areas are falling outside both the municipal and these private private service areas. And second point is I think like one of the reasons that a lot of these entities remain informal is because it's too onerous for them to become formal. We haven't incentivized them enough, or the current frameworks don't incentivize them enough to become formal. What can we do, I think, to make it easier for them to become formal, right? Nobody wants to be, like none of these people want to be informal. They have to.
Couple of quick responses to that. So from the Sabda Gebra example, right? So what I've seen is that this person, Akram, he's extremely fair and inclusive. You know, he's, whether it goes to, so for example, he doesn't charge anything from a widower who's running the household. He takes only, $50 from, a petty shop owner So there is some merit in, retaining them as informal, because the minute you bring a business model to it, the game changes. And we actually did that. You could perhaps ask IWMI for a report on this. So we actually looked at a business model on, it was scheduled desludging. Using scheduled desludging, we looked at a business model, user fees and all that. So this was one point. The second thing is, I think, yes, they are actually making profits. He was quite, happy to confess that he was making profits. But at the same time, his charging model was, extremely innovative. That bringing in a business structure to it might actually make them move away from it. So whether you want to structure it as a micro enterprise or not, it should be carefully done. You're looking at something innovative within the PPP architecture, something, on those lines, in order to see if this is a workable micro-enterprise.
I'll have to jump in. You have to be very quick and precise because you need to go to the next.
Yeah, so we don't lose sight of the problem. Two things. One is the conversation around the state and the role of the state in this whole thing, right? So coming back to what Anandita said at the beginning, this entire sector exists because this is a public function, like Prashant pointed out, which the state doesn't provide to people who are not on the network, right? And I think some of which we were talking about in the previous session about having a framework for fecal sludge management and non-networked sewage is part of the solution. And the second thing is, I don't think business models, leaving aside the nitty-gritties of it, I don't think business models or informality are necessarily antithetical to providing different services at different price points for different people, right? People do it corporates do it in other sectors. They have products for different segments of the population. Everybody recognizes that populations are segmented.
Yeah, so I'll just try to move on because we'll then lose out on time. So our next speaker, Dr. Sujit, is... Okay. So our next speaker would be K.B. Oblish. He is the national convener for the Safai Karmchari Kavalu Samiti, and he has been an activist who work on the issues of manual scavenging, especially of its legal aspects. He has first-hand experience of ground issues relating to manual scavenging. Today, he would talk about some of the current issues and strategies that are facing the community of manual scavengers. Mr. Oblish.
Yeah, friends,
Actually, I... This one, eh? This one, eh? This one. Anyway, friends, my name is Oblesh. I came from Karnataka. I am working with the Manual Scavengers community. Mainly, we are trying to prevent the manual deaths and the implement the legislation which is came. Not only now, even 50 years back, 60 years back, legislations are there. I am not saying there is no legislations. But only thing is, the implementation is the question. So, we are working on that. Just I am showing little the photos, how the people are dying. Yeah, next. Show it. Next. This is all STP deaths in Bangalore city and Karnataka, other parts. This is the scavengers, how they are working condition in the rural and urban. Yeah. Under the act, actually manual scavenging, all of you knows about, I am not going to explain about the manual scavenging. But under the legislation, it is a banned occupation and also cognizable and non-bailable criminal offence. But still, it is functioning. What I have shown the pictures, it is not the 10 years back or 5 years back pictures. Recent photos, just 1 year, this year and last year photos only. Rest of the, I have lot of photos actually. But because of the not implementation of the act, these deaths are happening. According to Karnataka census report 2011, 36,735 latrines from which night soil was removed by the either women or animals, and 61,802 latrines from which excreta was being disposed into the drain every day. So approximately, estimatedly, 98,533 insanitary latrines are there in Karnataka state itself only. I am not talking about the national level. If you calculate generally, 98,500 into 2, because 2 people need to clean 1 insanitary latrine approximately. So, more than 1 lakh manual scavengers are there in Karnataka state. But Karnataka government have identified so far only 935 people. That is also 458 urban area and 474 rural area. 2011 socio-economic and caste census report has brought out 15,735 manual scavengers are there in rural area. But government of Karnataka, rural development and Panchayat Raj, they have verified and they have came out, only 474 people are there out of 15,773. So, totally in Karnataka, 932 manual scavengers are there. And so far, from 2008 to 2018, 78 people have died while cleaning the manholes and the STPs. Out of 78 people, almost 32 people have died in the Bengaluru city only. 90% of the deaths happen in the STPs, sewage treatment plants. This is the urban area. STPs mainly having the well-educated peoples. Engineers, doctors, like social workers who are there well-educated, they are having a STPs in their apartments and their villas and their housing complexes. So they are taking the people and they are make them to go inside the clean the STPs and they are killing the people. One recent two people have died in Whitefield, called Whitefield in Bengaluru city. That apartment belongs to the one of the India vice president daughter house. So and also across the Bengaluru city there is 25,000 STPs are there still, but Pollution Control Board and Bengaluru Water Supply and Sewage Board and Bengaluru City Corporation don't have any data about with them. How many STPs are there, how many STPs are taken permission, how many STPs are taken permission for the maintenance. This data they don't have actually. Still last from 7 months we are trying to get the information from them because they don't have information. So this is the how the Green Tribunal judgment is functioning, pollution control is functioning, how the sewage boards are functioning, this is the thing. And Bengaluru city is the 1.15 crore population is there. 198 wards are there. Still now 50% of the area there is no sewage system. Almost 98 wards there is no sewage system. People all are having their individual pits, individual STPs. It's functioning with the private people only. So rampant manual scavengers are there, but unfortunately Bengaluru corporate city have identified only 202 people manual scavengers. This is the picture actually. So if you come to the legislations, people will think why so many people are dying, why only so much people only identified, there is no any law like that, people will think. But there is a law is there actually. I am not saying there is a different laws also, not only Manual Scavenging Act, there is a interlinking, different laws are there. For example, if you see 1993, the prohibition of constructing dry latrine act came. This act name itself is the prohibition of constructing dry latrines, but government of state governments and urban and rural people, they have constructed lakhs of incidental latrine in the name of public toilets. When they are constructing public toilet, that time they will give a connection, water connection. After 3 months, 4 months, the water will stop and it is becoming a dry latrines. Complete dry latrines are under the panchayats and under the local bodies. So there is lakhs of, according to, only Karnataka I am saying, there is 98,000 incidental latrines. If you take the 2011 census report across the India, 3,573 towns, they have done surveyed. More than 1 crore incidental latrines are there after the act came. So the 1993 act, almost it is not implemented properly.
Can I ask you a question which you had, you know, when we discussed earlier, you had told me this, and I think it's important for people to understand in terms of, you know, we were talking in the previous session about informal service providers. But there's also this informalization of who is doing the manual scavenging work. And, you know, that also has some implication for, you know, how, you know, many aspects of the work. You know, the nature of that work is also changing. And it may be changing more in the big cities, less in the small cities. Because earlier, municipal employees or municipal contract workers were doing a lot of this work. Now that's less and less and less the case. So maybe you could tell us a little bit more about that.
Yeah, manual scavengers means not only the municipal workers actually. Municipal contract workers, if you take Karnataka, there is a 48,000 municipal contract safai karmacharis are there. Safai karmachari and manual scavenging is a different dimension, definition is there. But
Officially, safai karmacharis are not, safai karmacharis are not manual scavengers, according to the 2013 Act. They are only sweepers. But because of the contractual system, outsourcing system, the people who are engaging in the sweeping, they are not able to get the proper time-to-time salary and also not a minimum wage also. So, they are all living in the urban area, in the towns, because of their survival, after their work, usually 90% of the safai karmacharis are engaging in manual scavenging. This is the one very tricky thing, because municipalities and government are not recognizing them as a manual scavengers, because they are saying we are not recruited any person as a manual scavengers. We have engaged only for safai karmacharis, but they are not forcefully and demandably they are making them to do a manual scavenging. If you take a urban area and semi-urban area, blocks and district level area, all safai karmacharis are cleaning every day open defecation, every day dry latrines, every day drainages, which I have shown the photos of, last photos. That is the rural area people are engaging. They are all paid by the municipality and outsourcing. Government is paying them. So, almost where I am taking 1 lakh manual scavengers are there, there is a 50 to 60% of the municipal workers are the manual scavengers. Rest of the people who are working privately and casually, manual scavengers are also there. In the Bangalore city, if you take in the separate area, there is a 30 people, 20 people, one gang is there. Their work is to go and clean the pits and STPs. That's called casual manual scavengers. They are completely manual scavengers. And majority of the people who are safai karmacharis, they are also the manual scavengers. So, they are not able to identify it. So, like this, there are different, and also third category, the people who are coming from migrant workers, from the villages and other states, who are people coming, the contractors are bringing them and forcing them to clean the, constructing new manuals and repairing old manuals. That time they are forcibly, they are going inside the cleaning the manholes, extrita everything. So like this, there are three category of workers are there. And again, I will come back to the legislations. And the PCR Act, you all aware about the PCR Act, Protection of Civil Rights Act 1975. Here also, it is a banned occupation. None of the people cannot able to forcibly to do the unclean occupation. That is there. And also, Bonded Labor Act 1976, it is also saying it is a forcible bonded labor thing. This is also abolition is there. And also, present 2013 Act, just before you are all discussing who was the accountability for this. 2013 Act very clearly says where there is incendiary latrine or any sea where the women excreta urine will flow on the road or anywhere, it is called incendiary latrine. District collector is the originally is the accountability person. No confusion. You are also don't keep any confusion, because one point I want to bring here, so many people are here, we are friends are there who are all working on the wastewater, waste management, water aid. So many organizations, so many professionals are here. Even we are also having a lot of confusions. Who is accountability? Who is a unorganized sector, organized sector? Like a government officials, we have a lot of confusions. Still now, none of the district collectors have not read about the 2013 Act. There is a clear definitions are there. Who are the responsibility? District collector is the implementation officer. And also, 2013 Act have a given a permission, provided, is designation also upgraded actually. So far, district collector and district magistrate is there. In the 2013 Act, it's upgraded his post, is a district executive magistrate. He can take a case, he can deliver everything, he can punish everything. Like that, the options are there, but unfortunately, he never opened up the Act actually. He didn't know, he don't know anything about that. And also, constitutional safeguards are there. All of you know, actually, Article 14, Article 16, Article 19, Article 17. This is all safeguard for the people, for protecting their dignity, human rights and all. And also, there are a lot of international conventions. 1958 convention. This is all conventions also protecting the human rights and the dignity of the workers and peoples. And in our India, there are a lot of reports, separate reports came about the eliminating this practice and dignifying the communities. Not now, the 1949 report of the scavengers living condition inquiry committee formed by state of Bombay. Like this several, 1953, there is a Kaka Kalekar commission report is there. And 1957, there is a Home and Affairs Department have formed a commission to make a report for the rehabilitation of the scavengers. So friends, because there are a lot of things are there, but unfortunately, our caste-minded legislators and caste-minded officers who are there, IAS officers who are there, they are still not, even still today, they are not ready for the implementing this act. So that's what people are, the people are forcibly killing us actually in the manholes and the STPs actually. And if you come to the cases, I have a lot of things to talk, but we will discuss whenever we get the time, because we have done a lot of study, research, we are working on intensively on this thing, but we have a lot of evidence also. So, we need to, one thing I want to talk, people who are working surrounding the issues, the water, waste management, all those things, and the advocates, we need to coordinate, we need to cooperate each other, and we need to protect the Dalits, most vulnerable community, untouchables among untouchables who are engaging in the manual scavenging, and we need to protect the manual scavengers. That is our one of the thing, and we need to, because 2013 act also, there is some loops are there actually. There is a few small loops are there. We need to demand to the government to make a proper amendment for that. So that is also there actually, and also we need to brought out a proper mechanized system. The FSTP is one of the good mechanized system actually, but unfortunately, government of India and government of states are not ready to fund properly, and they not make a proper funding and make a all over the city. Karnataka only one STPP I have seen that it is a very good thing, but now this year budget, they have planned for the 50 towns, FSTPs. They are going to make 50 towns. Recently, last week, we had a meeting with the DMA, and they are planning, they are making an action plan for the implementing 50 towns. So, we are demanding, because eradication of manual scavenging, only not rehabilitation actually, but we need to bring the mechanized system, like FSTP or a twin pit toilet, ecosystem toilet, like this, supposed to make. We need to total eradication, not only few people eradication, people rehabilitation, because later some people will come and engage. So we need to completely eradicate. That is only when the mechanized system and new technology will come, then only it is going to eradicate. So we are demanding with the central government and state government for this purpose. So thank you.
Thank you, Oblish. Thank you. That was very insightful. Arkeja, you would like to supplement, yeah.
So what I've tried to do here is I've been reading some of the cases and the different, you know, the legal principles that have emerged when people have tried to go to the court. I mean, you know, many things, many aspects of the law, and the law doesn't only obviously live in the courts, but one aspect of the law is, of course, what happens in the court. So when people have tried to go to the courts in relation to manual scavenging, what has been happening, what are the different types of legal strategies? So I've tried to classify those cases into different types of legal strategies, and those different types of legal strategies seem to have a temporality also. So there were slightly older strategies, and then there are newer strategies, and then there is the newest generation of strategies as well. So I'll talk very briefly about what has been happening in these cases. So the first few cases that we see relating to manual scavenging so we've looked at High Court and Supreme Court cases. We've tried as far as possible to collect all the cases, but you know, it takes several rounds of iterations to know that you've got everything. You know, we may have missed a few, which we learn along the way. So the first lot of these cases related to the prevention and eradication of manual scavenging. So, you know, they tried to establish the general principle that it is a human rights violation, that it is a violation of different constitutional rights, that it is work that's extremely, you know, undignified and hazardous. You know, so this dialogue has been going on in India at some level or the other in parliamentary debates, older laws, activist movements, etc. But the first lot of cases that came to the court were actually relating to, Safai Karamchari Andolan brought the case to the Supreme Court in 2003, but you know, it continued, and by the time they had the final, the case was finally closed, it was 2014. You know, and that case was focused on the 1993 Act. It was focused in the initial period of the case, it was focused on the non-implementation of states, non-implementation of the 1993 Act, so eradication of dry latrines. And states kept denying it. There was a, you know, process of a continuing mandamus, so the Supreme Court continued to monitor, and the Safai Karamchari Andolan was able to quite effectively leverage the institution of the Supreme Court as a monitoring mechanism, which brought a lot of awareness, a lot of visibility to the issues around manual scavenging. But for the most of the life of that case, most of the activity on that case remained focused on dry latrines. Around that time, though, there was increasingly attention to the issues, the deaths and health hazards faced by sewer workers. So this was becoming by then more and more prominent. And, you know, if people were becoming aware, these deaths had perhaps always been happening. As long as they've been sewage systems, there have probably been sewer deaths. But they were, you know, to a very large extent invisible. And so the first cases that came to the court actually, brought newspaper reports, because there was no other documentation of these deaths. There was no inquiries conducted in these deaths. So there was a case in Gujarat, Praveen Rashtrapal versus Chief Officer Khadi. Then there was a case in Tamil Nadu called A. Narayana versus Tamil Nadu. And there was this case in Delhi called, National Campaign for Dignity of Sewerage and Allied Workers versus MCD. In these three cases, together, I mean, basically they established before the 2013 Act came. 2013 Act formally extended the definition of manual scavenging to cover septic tanks and sewers. But these cases actually came before that, and they took the definition. I mean, the courts recognized all of these practices as manual scavenging. The courts also recognized, so now it's a decade ago, more than a decade ago, that the court already recognized that there should be no, manual entry into these systems should happen as little as possible, that workers should be entitled to compensation, they should be entitled to various other worker benefits, and all of these things had started happening in these cases. And so, you know, the general principles relating to manual scavenging started to get established here. Who was responsible for ensuring that this infrastructure is managed in a way to ensure that there's no manual scavenging? So here now, you know, these early cases, the Gujarat case, the Chennai case, and the Delhi case, the focus was on sewer systems. So it was relatively easier to establish who was responsible because, you know, unlike with non-network sewerage, here there's a clear public authority which is responsible for the maintenance of that sewerage. And these cases fixed that, you know, regardless of where the worker came from, there is some institutional, even if it's a contract worker, basically, there is some institutional responsibility of the public authority. they need to progressively buy machinery, they need to progressively set up the system to reduce manual entry, they need to buy protective equipment, they need to take up various measures for welfare and for compensation in cases of deaths. The Chennai case is, you know, particularly interesting. I was talking to Santosh about it in the morning also, because the Chennai case actually goes through, you know, how many kilometers of sewerage the city has, what is, you know, how much equipment do they need, what sort of equipment do they need to do mechanical cleaning, how do they translate, in the few cases, what are the rare instances where cleaning may still have to be manual, and what are the protections and safeguards that need to be undertaken for manual cleaning. So it established a very clear, the Chennai case established a very clear sort of institutional framework for the eradication side. Unfortunately, you know, it's a bit outdated. The framework in which they were looking at this issue of eradication, it's changed. At the time when, you know, when these cases were happening, at that time Chennai was around, you know, more than 90% sewered, because the Chennai urban area that came under the Metro Water Corporation was much smaller. Now it's around 70% sewered, because the area of Chennai has moved so much. As we know, the work has, you know, in the Delhi case also, there was very little discussion. You know, in the Delhi case, Justice AP Shah and Justice Muralidharan established very clear sorts of, you know, labor law protections for the people who were doing manual scavenging work, or were going to be, you know, or were suffering health hazards, regular health checkups, you know, various sorts of, you know, health and medical and workman benefits for the workers who were going to be involved in this case. But there was very little discussion about what was happening in the non-sewered areas. I mean, it was almost invisible in that case. There was a brief mention of it. Delhi Jal Board and the authorities never responded. They never really acknowledged that part of it. You know, the Gujarat municipalities, the Gujarat municipalities, the court told them, you know, this contracting out business is a problem, so now you stop contracting and you start doing your own sewer cleaning. And you progressively buy equipment as much as you have resources, so you can, you know, make it mechanical over time. But there was no reference to non-sewerage, and of course, the Gujarat municipalities haven't stopped contracting anything. No one has stopped contracting. In fact, the scale of kind of outsourcing, contracting, informalization has increased massively in these years. And so these principles that these cases established are quite difficult to apply in non-network scenarios where, you know, the cleaning work is happening on site, on private properties, in septic tanks, and in private STPs. We need a new sort of legal framework that addresses these issues, and these cases, the general principles of these cases, are not enough. On the one aspect where the cases have been quite clear and unequivocal is that there's a clear liability of the local. So, you know, coming one step below, so, you know, we had those general principles, and then there's the issue of compensation and rehabilitation. So this principle was first established in the Delhi Jal Board case, in the Delhi case, and then reaffirmed by the Supreme Court. The quantum of compensation, the 10 lakh amount that we talk about now, this was established in the Safai Karamchari Andolan versus Union of India. Supreme Court set this 10 lakh amount, and that's the amount that has kind of remained, you know, the practice up till now. And yet, and you know, the courts very clearly have said that regardless of whether that person is a contract worker or anything else, you as the public authority that maintains that infrastructure is responsible for his death, and you have to pay compensation. They've said this is not a private claim that you have to, you know, that you can say, oh, go after this one, go after that one. You can recover it from the contractor or the subcontractor eventually if you want, but you as the state have to pay the compensation, and you have to pay it now. And, you know, the courts have been consistent in this. And consistently we find that the public authority that's responsible for paying the compensation in all the cases raises the same objections, which involves the saying that the person didn't actually die doing manual scavenging, he died doing something else. Or they say he's a contract worker and so we are not responsible. He was employed by so-and-so contractor and therefore we weren't responsible. Most recently, there was this case in Delhi, Rajesh, and the one I mentioned at the bottom, Rajesh and another versus Delhi Jal Board 2018, where, you know, and this is a very typical Delhi issue. So all the Delhiites who, you know, if you read about these cases in the newspaper, you'll know of this. They say, you know, Delhi Jal Board, or in this case, DSIDC, which is responsible for maintaining the industrial estates, They said, we know nothing about this. We have our own protocol for maintaining our own sewerage systems. Nobody filed an official complaint. Nobody called us and told us the sewer line was blocked. Some private owners have called these workers and they have gone and done this cleaning. So we don't know anything about this. The private owner said, we don't know anything about this. We weren't even there. One private owner said, I'd gone to attend a wedding. One private owner said, my property is actually so far away from this place. So everyone tried to get out of this. The Delhi High Court, however, said that there is strict liability of DSIIDC for its infrastructure. And this is, you know, DSIIDC has to pay the compensation and they can then figure out, they also mentioned that there is a criminal proceeding that's going on in the Metropolitan Magistrates Court. So once that is sorted out, you can go and recover the compensation from those people, but you are responsible for your infrastructure. And, you know, considering how clear this principle is from the legal perspective and from what the courts are doing, every time you hear a newspaper report, every time you see a newspaper report about when the compensation is not being paid or something, there is some issue like this that the authorities are still continuing to say. Finally, coming to the aspect about the criminal liability, the various provisions in the Manual Scavenging Act and in other acts which relate to the criminal liability for the act of manual scavenging. So the act, I mean, as far as the act is concerned, there's no separate liability for when someone dies. The act, you know, the act making someone do manual scavenging or making someone do hazardous cleaning or having an insanitary latrine, all of these are criminal offences as far as the act is concerned. There is also very strong provisions in the SCST Prevention of Atrocities Act, which relate quite specifically to manual scavenging. And, you know, that too relates to the act of manual scavenging. Unfortunately, though, we find that, you know, because the focus, the legal strategy previously, and a lot of the legal focus has been on the compensation cases, which is the civil part. So not enough has happened to actually establish what happens on the criminal side. You know, in the compensation cases where we talked about, where the courts came down heavily on the public authorities and said, you're responsible for paying compensation, nobody was really discussing what was happening as far as the criminal liability of the act of manual scavenging was concerned. Only now we find that there are a few recent cases, and this is particularly a Karnataka phenomena, that there are a few recent cases where there's one Gujarat case, two Karnataka cases, where they've actually tried to go after the act of manual scavenging as a criminal offence. And it's had mixed success, in spite of the fact that the legal provisions are quite clear, they've had mixed success in the court. The last case, which is, I think, very recent, and it's probably not gone all the way through, is the National Institute of Rock Mechanics versus Kolar, where, you know, they said that there's this whole estate that's maintained by this institute. It has a lot of septic, it has a lot of latrine pits, and they have no provision for mechanical cleaning. And they have these three chaps who are doing all the manual scavenging in this case. The National Institute went and raised all kinds of technical objections, saying, you know, these guys can't file an FIR against us. Who are they? The scavengers haven't complained. This has happened. That has happened. The court said, no. It's an FIR is to be filed, and the criminal side investigation should happen, and it's the responsibility of the police to take it up. Finally, very, very briefly, I think this is relevant from the aspect of, it's actually relevant from the perspective of the PPPs and from the perspective of service providers, that there have been a few cases that have established a few confusing principles around, around what types of services can be procured in the sector. So, you know, Metro Waste Handling versus Delhi Jal Board, it's a very clear case. It was not very confusing, actually. The Delhi Jal Board put out a notice saying that they wanted to empanel service providers who they would give preference to service providers who were from the manual scavenging community or were SCSTs. And a large Delhi-based service provider challenged that, saying that's an unfair, like, restriction on trade. And the court said, no, it's not. It's a reasonable classification. Eliminating manual scavenging, providing rehabilitation, all of these are legitimate objectives, and, you know, it's a measure to help a disadvantaged class, so it's, you know, you can go ahead. And I think that's, I mean, so the nature of, like, what sorts of services can be contracted in the sector, I think it may become an important precedent. There are a couple of other cases where people have, you know, gone the other way. So they actually, I mean, Sulabh International, you know, almost kind of arm twisted the Bihar government into saying, give the contract only to us because we're the only ones who have the experience to do this. And you can't give the work to anyone else. So we are going to see, this, you know, as competition in the sector opens up, there's, you know, and there's money in the sector, obviously, in spite of all its disadvantages, there is money. We are going to see some complexities emerging on the commercial side. And, you know, it's for the people who actually design these frameworks, design these policies, design these laws, to think about the social and commercial goals, and to think of a good mix where there's viability for the operators and the social goals are, you know, so this is very emerging. This is very little that's happened in this space at the moment, but we are going to see much more competition here. And I suppose it's just a early note that we can start thinking about this. So yeah, thank you for that.
Thank you, Arkaja. That was very insightful. Any questions, comments? Please.
Start with you. Just an observation. In Delhi, we have worked with manual scavengers in the Northeast Chatter with the DM and the Delhi government. And the issue which is coming is, you know, you are talking of, you know, 10 lakhs of rupees. We were not able to get 40,000 rupees relief because they said they are not registered workers, because there is no manual scavenging in Delhi. And the state has actually written saying that we have no manual scavenger. So even at the level of DM, it was such a big challenge. But he managed to persuade somebody whom he knew in the ministry to release 40,000 rupees, but this is only for a group of 50 people, and these are people are going to be rehabilitated, and many of them have come back to us saying that we do not want to work on jobs which give us 10,000 rupees because we earn much more, and it's about life and death, but at the same time it's also about our economics. And at the same time, DLSA has a list of 1,000 people who are manual scavengers. They have not been able to do anything in spite of having the money. The Delhi Jal Board knows that there are manual scavengers. They say they are private contractors. They work on their own. They have a consent saying that I am doing this on my own, so if I die, it doesn't matter. So now all these are challenging issues. So you cannot even approach. So in spite of all the court judgments, nothing moves on the ground.
So, you know, just quickly to respond to that, I mean, you know, this point was brought up in that Metro waste handling case versus Delhi Jal Board. Metro, the company that was challenging that procurement, they said that Delhi government has claimed that there are no manual scavengers in Delhi. Now you're creating a kind of procurement notice where you want 100% reservation for manual scavengers, which is a class that doesn't exist. So, I mean, the Delhi High Court, in a very clear judgment, said that if the Delhi government is not owning up to its responsibility and not honestly counting the manual scavengers, that's their problem. But if they are doing this procurement, so basically they said that, you know, you can't stop, exactly the point, that you can't stop doing any of your rehabilitation compensation measures because you haven't done the survey and you haven't registered the manual scavengers, you know. So, but the point is exactly what I'm saying, that in spite of the fact that these legal principles are so clearly established, every time you engage with the public authorities on this issue, they come up with the same objections. And perhaps what we need is a kind of a, because many of these principles are in the cases, they're not in the act. So perhaps what we need is a ready reference of, you know, these are well-established legal principles.
The point is, the state committee has been set up in the district, and they have people from all sectors in that, people from all government departments. In spite of that, it does not happen. And the other thing is, who is a manual scavenger? That definition is not clear. They say ye contract workers. Manual scavenging ko define karne ke baad bhi they are not very clear. So, you know, there are so many arguments that you really don't know where to start.
Absolutely.
No, actually,
Oblish, will you switch on your mic?
Problem all over country, all jail boards, all corporations, they are still asking who is the manual scavenger. They are the contract workers. They are the casual labor. So many things they are telling. But 2013 Act completely, clearly they say. And also there is a option for self-declaration for the people who are there. They can put an application self-declaration. Within 20 days, the health inspector should come and verify the person. If he did a manual scavenging, he can identify as a manual scavenger. this is the simple procedure are there.
The simple procedure they are not implementing.
They are not implementing. But in Karnataka, out of 78 manhole deaths, 68 people have got 10 lakh rupees compensation. 68. Another people also, money is ready. But unfortunately, they came from outside state and outside person. We don't have any proper address and how to identify. That's what the pending is there. So, after 2013 Act came, we have identified more than 500 people as a manual scavenger. So, it need a very, very close intervention with the government and district collector. District collector is just is closing his eyes and working it about the manual scavenger. He is not open eyes. Otherwise, it's not a big issue. It is a very simple issue actually.
Yeah. Manish, you had a point.
And Parag had a question.
Yeah.
And
Rajesh, yeah.
I think there are two, three things that come out of this. One is that death cannot be the point of intervention, right? And for the most part, through these cases and elsewhere, and I think it's actually nice to see that there are a few cases where intervention has started before someone dies, right? People should not have to
and
die for...
Only two cases in Karnataka.
Yeah, and people should not die for relief to come, right? Relief has to happen before people die. That I think that is the first... Exactly. Prevention is the most important part, right? So one part of it is the mechanization. And I think in the opening session, there was a comment that referring to UP,
mm-hmm.
that in certain places, lanes are too narrow or systems are
mm-hmm.
not feasible for the for existing. I don't think that is a sustainable argument any longer. And I think that needs to be recognized that, I mean, if there is no mechanical solution available, there has research has to be directed towards that end. And I think recently we've been seeing these robots and these other smaller contraptions that are being developed for ending manual scavenging. And the other part is that for anyone to work in this sector, right, with cleaning, right, not manual scavenging, but whatever, non-hazardous cleaning of wherever necessary, informalization is an essential part of the problem. Right, the reason why there is no accountability, the reason why people are dying is because they are in a structure where there is no clear contract or nexus of employment. They're not in a job that pays them fair wages on a regular basis, right? They have to do it on an ad hoc basis, which also again takes away the accountability from that entire structure. So the only way I think that, the only way I see this being resolved is if existing de-sludge and other people using services of these people are formally registered, right? Registered in some way and regulated by the state to ensure that they have fair working conditions and also that their activities are carried out in a manner that doesn't harm the environment or other people.
Yeah, thanks, Vinay. Do you mind? Parag, Rajesh, Vanishri, and then Aditya.
The compensation, that 10 lakh compensation mechanism that is there, that actually comes from the Supreme Court judgment. The Act specifies a very different compensation mechanism, which is for anybody who's a manual scavenger.
Mm-hmm.
This is for deaths.
Yeah, that's the rehabilitation.
So what happens also in the Act, it says that if there is a criminal prosecution for manual scavenging, if somebody has employed a manual scavenger, there's a limitation period of 6 months. From the incident of manual scavenging, you have to bring the case within 6 months, otherwise you cannot bring the case. Secondly, the way manual scavenging has been defined in the Act is if you have protective gear, you are no longer a manual scavenger. That is the reason why most state governments, once they have hired contractors and they have specified that you have to provide protective gear, they do not identify these people as manual scavengers. But the bigger issue is that when the Safai Karmachari case was happening, a lot of states filed affidavits saying they do not have any manual scavengers. So when the 2013 Act came and there was a self-identification mechanism, the states could not really go and admit that they had this many manual scavengers. So they have been kind of denying that and taking shelter under the Act and the exceptions to the definition of manual scavenger. Now, the point is that all these cases which grant compensation do not look into the criminal side at all. when they grant this 10 lakh compensation, even in this 68 cases, Karnataka is actually one of the states which has the highest number of these compensation cases. Whether it be the court or the authorities granting this compensation, they should start parallel criminal investigation. In a lot of instances, what has happened is people have self-identified, got the compensation, and they have gone back to manual scavenging. Because as long as they are sewer, somebody has to clean them, unless you introduce mechanized means. And because this is a caste-related issue, even when they get employment in the same sector. So they will be employed as something to do with cleaning, as Safai Kamishari or something. So it's very difficult for them to get out. If they are getting employment in that same sector, they would eventually go back when there is contracted work. So it is not just the law that needs to change. There has to be some kind of investment, which again the Act talks about, technological solutions to manual scavenging. So that aspect has been ignored. And the courts which give out compensation do not talk about, none of these judgments talk about what is the amount of investment the state government or the municipal corporations are making into mechanized solutions for cleaning. Otherwise, it's somebody has to clean it. It's the reality of the situation is very simple. It's like even if somebody gets out of the profession, they will go back in eventually.
So, you know, I'd just like to very briefly comment on that before we go to the next question. I mean, one of the things is, of course, that the whole design for, you're talking about the rehabilitation provisions of the Act. So the whole design and the there's a rehabilitation scheme, and actually last year in at the Center for Policy Research, there was the Accountability Initiative. They carried out a kind of budget review of what was happening under the self-employment scheme for manual scavengers. And then we, you know, this year we're doing some more work on the scheme as well. But one of the issues is the entire thing rests on the manual scavenger becoming a self-employed entrepreneur. So you're going to give him livelihood training, and then he's going to become this self-employed entrepreneur, which, you know, for a community or a class that has had no previous entrepreneurial experience, no entrepreneurial networks, you know, nothing like that. You could have many other sorts of rehabilitation options which might have made much more sense, and which might be much more, you know, you need some stable source of income to compensate, I mean, to make up for the fact that you won't have a manual scavenging income. And, you know, a self-employment model where the person is going to become a shopkeeper or start running an auto rickshaw need not have been the only solution. But unfortunately, that's how the thinking and the design of the government scheme has progressed also.
Yeah.
But I won't take up more time. I think there are lots of comments.
Rajesh.
I just
take the mic.
Just wanted to emphasize that this definition is a fairly critical issue because we've seen that come up in practically every environmental case that has been argued in court. Like, for example, the coastal regulation zone notification is one such thing where I was involved in, that there is this definition of a traditional inhabitant, right? And it clearly says that, you know, customary uses, shorefront, etc., etc. But there was this case in Goa where there is this, person who has a villa and fairly well-to-do, who came and argued that he needs to expand his villa because he's a traditional inhabitant. He's been living there for so many years, etc., etc. And similarly, another case in Chennai where there was a road that the entire case hinged on the road. And we actually provided satellite maps to show that there was no road that existed prior to 1991. But the court went with something like what the Tahsildar certificate, stating that there was a road and it favored the, the opposite party. So I would like to emphasize that you need to spend, though, sir, you know, you're saying that the definition is fairly clear, but it's often left to the courts to interpret what is the right definition. So I think we need to spend some time on definitions particularly.
It's also mentioned about the definition. Definition is almost clear. Only understanding is not properly. There is Supreme Court, 2014 judgment came. They are also mentioned about the definition actually. They have mentioned two judgments, Safai Karmachari and Manual Scavenger, both is there.
Yeah.
Only thing is people who have understanding, that is the problem actually. And also the rehabilitation thing actually. There is NSFDC there in Delhi. Crores of rupees is there. But unfortunately, they are not planning properly because 2013 identified 302 manual scavengers in Karnataka. Still now they have not rehabilitated them with the suitable alternate employment. So people, what can do? They will go back again for the scavenging work. So somebody's, some professional institute supposed to take a responsibility for providing an alternate employment for the scavengers all over the India actually. Otherwise, only identification, only giving 40,000 one-time cash assistance is not rehabilitation actually. Somebody has to take responsibility, analyze them and provide them training or whatever their interest, alternate employment, scavengers interest. They can provide the sufficient money for them. Then only we are going to prevent them actually. Otherwise, they will go back again for the same work.
For sure. So as we are eating up our lunch time, Anishri, can you?
A very short addition to what Akaja said is like we are talking about the non-mechanized thing, but I'll go for an example in Bangalore whereby a study, even the mechanized truck cleaners which were coming and de-sludging from a big hotel were even more clueless as to where to de-sludge their thing. And it was clouded all under the shroud of secrecy, that is, that it has to be done at night and there's no way that they can, you know, do their operations in the morning. They have no idea, and they, their main duty is not rather de-sludging, rather to find spots where that can be done in a cloud of secrecy, meaning simply even in Bangalore, we do not have, you know, proper options even when they are using a suction pump or a, you know, proper mechanized truck, and they are approaching the hotel who is, you know, kind of taking their services. So such secrecy even for mechanized services. And again, that caste angle as to all three of them who were, you know, employed in this belong to the Dalit community, you know. So just an
Aditya. Aditya and then Yogini. Any other questions, then we will wrap up for this session. So, Aditya.
I have two questions for Mr. Obulesh. So this is regarding the increasing amount of informalization and, you know, sort of unsaid contractualization of the employment of manual scavengers. So, like, people who are engaged in manual, the act of cleaning all these pits and any sort of containment structures. Well, as you also mentioned that you would refer to Safai Karamcharis as people who are engaged in manual scavenging, right? So in that sort of a thing, with the increasing informalization, do you think that reinforces the word of mouth sort of network that already exists in, you know, figuring out who is supposed to come and clean the tank? And also if there is a tie-up between the truck operators and people who empty septic tanks and these sort of things. Like, there have been cases where, like, trucks are not able to, you know, clean the containment structures completely, and there has been a further requirement for manual cleaning. And there's one more question. From the perspective of social reproduction, do you think that, you know, the 2013 Act and subsequently the larger informalization of this sort of work, has that is that worsening the issue of, like, people from specific communities going for manual scavenging, or has, do you think it should be able to reduce it?
No, it is not reduced actually. See, the 2013 Manual Scavenging Act have a biggest problem. The official definition and official identification is the biggest problem. See, many people or Safai Karmacharis are doing manual scavenging. Unfortunately, they are not able to identify because the government officials saying that they are the Safai Karmacharis, they are not manual scavengers. So, finished. Even if he is due 10 months, 9 months, 1 month, he is not becoming a scavenger. That is one biggest problem is it. And also the 2013 Act, if the person registered as a manual scavenger, only he can able to get the rehabilitation. Otherwise nothing will happen. And also the Act also implementing only the person will have engaged, registered as a manual scavenger. That is the one biggest problem is there. And first one who has could know that I didn't understand. Can you be able to report that?
As in like the truck operators. If they have a tie-up with the manual scavengers, if there is a further requirement for manual cleaning, despite...
No, that is a separate department is there, no? The say water and sewage department. Under the sewage department, the truck, the assistants are working with the truck actually. Jetting machine, sucking machines. So what happened, the jetting machine and sucking machine also not a proper solution actually. So the sucking machine will go only the straight roads only. It's not able to go in gullies and small crossroads and here there. If it is go also, they will take a long pipe and it won't able to suck everything, fecal and water. Sometime the 2-3 people supposed to go inside and keep the pipe inside. That is the problem is there. So because of that, so many people are engaging in the exterior cleaning actually. Sometime without any cloth, they will go inside and they will do everything actually. So jetting and sucking machine also not a completely mechanized machines actually. There also need some good invention, proper machines actually. But now they are telling, the sewage board people are telling, no, now that is a clutching machine came, it is drilling, that, this and all telling. But old UGDs, the fecal will tightly stuck there actually.
Yeah.
There it machine will, it won't work actually. Somebody have to go inside and drill that and make the water and excreta broken, then you have to keep the machine. Like that, there a technical problem is there actually. It is not a completely solution actually.
Yeah. Yogini, and then we close. Huh?
Yeah. So I have 2 points to make. First is that while everybody has commented that there are adequate safeguards in terms of law, how do we imagine that there will be transparency from bodies when the same bodies that are involved in, say, regulating the buildings are the same bodies that are involved that are also accountable for preventing manual scavenging? So I just would like to hear about or what everybody has to say about this. And secondly, can we imagine a scenario where there is no manual scavenging but without the kind of building regulations and other design mandatory things? Can we even imagine that? So unless and until we have an overarching regulation or system, can we separate these two components?
I think we both have a response. Yeah.
No, according to me, the Manual Scavenging Act 2013, which is there functioning now, it needs to immediately amendment some of the points. We have already listed actually. We have submitted to Niti Aayog also to for recommendation for this amendment. That is one. And design you spoken, no? The design thing. This Swachh Bharat mission which is working in India, it need to relook into their mandate, their guidelines, and they have to make a proper guideline and whatever the strategy is there, that strategy should relook into the, and they have to make it to the design things actually. Because Swachh Bharat have a lot of money and they have to brought out the proper design of the sanitation thing and proper design, sanitation, technology, everything. Then only this problem will go to solve actually.
Absolutely, but I think I fully agree, but I think one broader perspective, and this is actually Dipinder's point, who's been very quiet through this session, but about the role of the, you know, the rights-based perspective. So, you know, there is one way of address, you know, we have two different sort of paths, and, you know, actually there needs to be action on both paths. So while we talk quite a lot about the need to strengthen technical regulations, the need to bring safety into the environmental regulations, and, you know, have this whole framework where institutional responsibilities are so clear that, you know, there is a whole line of service provision that addresses the business that is otherwise being you know, dealt with through manual scavenging. So we don't, you know, we have no shortcuts as far as that is concerned, that, oh, okay, we'll look the other way and someone will come and do this work. But on the other hand, I mean, this issue would have remained completely invisible. You know, it's been invisible for far too long. It's still not as visible as it should be. And it's because of the rights-based perspective, and it's because of the activism in the community and the larger sort of human rights activism that's actually brought this issue into the framework of, you know, being clearly recognized as a human rights violation, as a violation of constitutional rights. And I think we're not ready to give up on that. We can't completely technicalize it and, you know, give up on the rights dimension, because, I mean, in my perspective, I don't envisage that happening without a strong role of the rights perspective.
Yeah, so thank you all for your participation, and we break out for lunch right now, and we have to be back by 2 for our next session. It's already 1:50.
We have lunch, an Assamese inspired lunch from the Assam Bhavan caterers, so I hope you'll enjoy it.
Yeah. Please join us for lunch.